Good afternoon, good morning, depending on where you folks are. My name is Kelly Kramer. I'm a partner in our Washington, D.C. office, and I'm also the co-chair of Mayor Brown's White Collar Defense and Compliance Practice Group. Joining me today as co-presenters, or really the principal presenters, are Salim Saoud and Arturo Vecchi. Salim's a partner in the Rio de Janeiro office of Tuwheel and Checker, and he's a member of the Global Anti-Corruption and FCPA practice. Salim and I have worked together in a number of different cases, anti-corruption cases coming out of Brazil in particular. Arturo is an associate in the Rio de Janeiro office. He's also a member of the Global Anti-Corruption and FCPA practice. Before we begin, I've got a couple of housekeeping announcements. First, as we go along, we hope that you'll ask questions by using the Q&A panel on the right side of your screen. We'll make every effort to answer questions towards the end of the webinar. If we're unable to answer your question during the presentation, we will follow up with you directly after the webinar has ended. Second, regarding CLE credit, we will be providing an alphanumeric code at some point during the presentation. In order to receive CLE credit, participants must record this code on the virtual sign-in sheet that was emailed to you with the login instructions for today's program. And finally, I've got one caveat, which is that the views that Salim, Arturo, and I express today are our own and should not be attributed to our firm or our clients. With that, let's get started on the substance. And I'll soon turn the presentation over to my colleagues in Brazil. But before I do, I wanted to offer just a few thoughts to sort of put this into some perspective. First, if you told me 5 years ago that Brazil would prosecute and jail the heads of its construction companies, senior Petrobras officials, its political elites, including possibly its former president, I wouldn't have believed it. And no one would have. And that's not because no one believed that Brazil had a corruption problem. Many people saw that. It's because no one believed that Brazil's institutions were prepared to take on the problem in such a dramatic and forceful way. But what we've seen in Brazil over the past few years is nothing short of a sea change in terms of how the country deals with white-collar crime in general and corruption in particular. And second, in light of that, it makes you rethink a little bit your assumptions about the political orders in the world. For many years, Brazil's been lumped into a collection of developing nations known as the BRICS for Brazil, Russia, India, and China. Operation Car Wash makes me think that it may not be fair to continue labeling Brazil like that. You could not imagine, no one could possibly imagine, something like Operation Car Wash taking place today in China or Russia. And the fact that Brazil's initiated and sustained the prosecutions suggests to me, at least, that its legal institutions are far more advanced and independent of its supposed peer nations. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Salim and Arturo to bring you up to speed on what's actually happening in Brazil today.
Thank you, Kelly. Good morning and good afternoon, everyone. So for those of you who did not participate in our previous calls, I will go very briefly, and I'll really be brief on that, on what is the scheme and what has happened so far. So the Operation Car Wash scheme was unveiled by the public prosecutors and the federal police, and they believed that a number of construction companies would pay bribes to certain Petrobras officials and also to certain political parties by hiring construction companies, by first inflating the contract that they have with Petrobras. The Petrobras officials would get part of the money of these inflated accounts, inflated contracts, and part of the money would be then deviated to some political parties. The main political parties that received funds, according to these investigations, would be PT, which is the party of President Rousseff and former President Lula, PMDB, which is the party of Vice President Michel Temer, and PP, which is also a party that supports the government. The operation started actually a long time ago. It started in 2009, investigating certain money launderers that were using gas stations to launder money. And that's why it's called Operation Car Wash. The names took to it, and but several different phases have received different names. When it became an investigation on Petrobras, then the phases started to be covered by the media and also by the police. It all started in March of 2014 with the disclosure of some links between some of these money launderers and some Petrobras executives. We had an executive arrested in March of that year, and these executives ended up agreeing to a plea bargain. That only happened later in the year, but this plea bargain actually initiated the whole investigation. By August of 2014, the police already had a fair amount of information. There were other investigations of corruption of Petrobras going on around the world. SBM Offshore signed a deal with the Dutch authorities on the same, but we're also approaching the elections. So the police stopped for a while for the elections. The elections actually occurred at the time, and in October, and President Rousseff was re-elected. Here you can see not only President Rousseff, but also Vice President Temer, who's from PMDB. After the election, the operation continued, and lots of people remember Operation Doomsday, in which the major executives of construction companies were arrested. This is how the year 2014 ended. The year of 2015 started with much more action. The investigation started in January with the arrest of Nestor Severo. Nestor Severo is also highly ranked, was also a highly ranked Petrobras executive. His arrest is very relevant for something that we will see towards the end of the year. The investigations continued, but then the police investigations and the public prosecutor's investigations started to get mixed with politics. With the new legislature starting in 2015, Eduardo Cunha was elected Speaker of the House. Here's a picture of Eduardo Cunha, who has been compared by some with Frank Underwood of House of Cards. Eduardo Cunha was elected defeating a candidate from PT, the party of the president, and he soon approved the commencement of a new Congressional Investigations Committee on Petrobras. Right after that happened, the attorney general, the public prosecutor, started investigations against certain politicians at the Supreme Court. And as a result of the investigation committee that Eduardo Cunha had created, he was deposed. And in his deposition, he was asked whether he had offshore bank accounts. He ended up saying that he did not have offshore bank accounts. This will be relevant for something that we'll see towards the end of the year. Well, the investigations continued with a number of different phases, a number of different arrests. Of relevance during the year of 2015, we have the Petrobras issued financial statement in April acknowledging 6.2 billion reais of losses due to corruption. Right after, Marcelo Odebrecht, the president and main shareholder of Odebrecht, one of the largest construction companies, and actually one of the largest companies in Brazil, also was arrested. Once again, politics started to interfere with the investigations. In September, a request for the impeachment of President Rousseff was filed before the House of Representatives. Another phase happened in September called Mitsundorma. Mitsundorma is named after the famous area from Turandot that basically says no one shall sleep. That was the federal police telling the politicians and the individuals concerned about Operation Kawash that they shall all be vigilant because something will happen to them. And there was also a way of the federal police telling that it will take a time, and you will see that while they took about a month between each one of the phases until then, the federal police then started to take much longer time between the different phases of Operation Car Wash. But while the federal police was doing their own investigations and not making it very public, politics started to become more active. And right after this phase of Operation Car Wash, Eduardo Cunha's accounts in Switzerland were unveiled. So he has said in the beginning of the year that he had no offshore accounts, but now his accounts became public. At the same time, actually a few days later, TCU, which is a federal audit committee, rejected the accounts of Dilma Rousseff for 2014. As a result of that, the impeachment request that had been filed in the beginning of September was amended, and the legal department of the House of Representatives issued an opinion in favor of the impeachment. This has only happened once before. In 1992, when former President Collor, now Senator Collor, was impeached. As a result of Cunha's bank accounts being unveiled, the opposing parties filed a motion against him at the Ethics Committee of the House of Representatives, and alleging that he was that he lied at the floor of the House, and as a result, he should be removed from office. The proceedings started in November, and there was a fair amount of maneuvering during that time to postpone the commencement of the proceedings. But the proceedings actually started toward the end of the month. A couple of phases happened in Operation Car Wash, and then something that moved Operation Car Wash to different levels, which was the arrest of Senator Delcídio Amaral and also the banker of BTG Pactual, Andrés Tevez. Both of them were arrested on allegations of obstruction of justice. Delcídio Amaral had been allegedly, at the time allegedly, now we know that he has confessed his actions. He had offered money to the family of Nestor Severov, who was at the time negotiating a plea bargain. His intention was that Nestor Severov would not enter into a plea bargain if he received funds that would be provided to his family. At the time, he was arrested. And that changed the Operation Car Wash to achieve the core of the PT government. Operation Car Wash continued in 2015 also with interference from the politics side, because on December 2nd, Eduardo Cunha, who was at the time facing an ethics proceeding at the House, decided to accept the impeachment request and submit it to the floor of the House. There were a number of events involving the impeachment process back then, but in parallel to this, Operation Car Wash continued, and Eduardo Cunha was the focus of the 22nd phase of Operation Car Wash. This is how the year of 2015 ended, with Operation Car Wash now taking a hit on the politicians and with the impeachment process being discussed. So the impeachment proceeding, which was initiated in 2016, I'm sorry, in 2015, and towards the end of the year, there were a number of procedural measures taken at the time, but it was ended up being suspended by the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court suspended the proceeding on allegations that the Speaker of the House failed to follow some transparency requirements by allowing for secret voting and by allowing the post to appoint different candidates. Traditionally, the leaders of the post, they appoint specific candidates to be members of a committee that will draft an opinion on the impeachment request, and that once that list of committee members is submitted, then it's either approved or rejected. What happened under the Speaker of the House, Eduardo Cunha, was that he allowed the leaders of the parties to present a list, but he also allowed other candidates to submit their candidacy. So there were competing lists to the committee, and the list that was not appointed by the leaders of the parties ended up having more votes. They had a total of 272 votes. I guess 199 votes there were for the list, for the official list. The Supreme Court voided that election and determined that the traditional procedures should be followed and that the voting should be open, should not be secret. So the proceedings currently suspended, and once the Supreme Court issued the opinion, the Speaker of the House appealed, and the Supreme Court is actually deciding it on it today. So we will likely have a decision on either today or tomorrow, and once the decision is issued, then the proceeding is probably going back to the floor of the House. Now I'm going to pass the floor to Arthur Vecchi, who will explain the developments of Operation Kawash in 2016. And you will see that if there was much more events, and if the year 2015 was much more dramatic than the year 2014, the year 2016 there was much more action going on. Arthur, please go ahead.
Thank you, Salim. The city was sent to house arrest on about a month ago, and the official reason for his release was that he no longer was a threat to the investigation, but rumors had it that he had entered a plea bargain. And parts of his plea bargain leaked to the press and implicated President Dilma Rousseff, former President Lula, the Minister of Justice, and other high-profile political figures. The CJU decided not to return to the Senate, although he is still a senator, and he is facing an ethics proceeding at the Senate and can be expelled. And as of today, the Federal Supreme Court rejected a request by the CJU to dismiss his case in front of the Senate.
This is an interesting fact, because Desiderio Amaral, once he was arrested and his arrest was approved by the floor of the Senate, he became a defendant in an ethics proceeding before the Senate, and he could actually be removed from office because of that. So he enters a plea bargain, which basically requires you to confess a wrongdoing, and his expectation was that the plea bargain would be kept secret for at least 6 months. His idea behind that was that he would be able to defend his case before the floor of the Senate, and he would avoid being removed. We do know, and back when he was released, it was only a rumor, but we do know that he has actually entered into a plea bargain, and one of the conditions for the plea bargain to be approved was that the justice overseeing the case, Justice Jerry Zavascki, he refused to allow the secrecy of the plea bargain. Arturo will explain a little bit about what the plea bargain says.
Yes, and there are several politicians that are implicated in his plea bargain, and including President Dilma Rousseff. He affirmed that she tried to interfere in Operation Kawash by appointing a justice to the Superior Court of Justice, that is below the Federal Supreme Court here in Brazil. And President Dilma denied the fact. He also affirmed that Lula also tried to interfere in the person to wash and told Delcídio himself to pay an allowance for Cervera so that his friend Bunlai, President Lula's ex, former President Lula's friend Bunlai, not to implicate, not be implicated further in Operation Car Wash. And Vice President Michel Temer is also implicated by his plea bargain. Delcídio affirms that he was aware of the corruption scandal in Petrobras and also confirmed certain indications to the board, to Petrobras board. And
the plea bargain also makes links to Mensalão. Mensalão, to those of you who don't know, is the latest, largest scandal in Brazilian history. That was a scandal that occurred during the administration of President Lula. And the scandal consisted on using funds that were paid to bribes to the political parties, and mostly to the government political parties, so that they would then be distributed among the politicians, representatives and senators, that by receiving a monthly allowance, hence it's called the Salão, then they would vote for the government.
And then there is the next phase of Operation Carwash, which is called acarajé, which is a reference to a typical food here in Brazil, which is also a slang for bribery. And it focused on João Santana, who was the Workers' Party marketing advisor, and his wife. So then again, you have the political paths that Operation Car Wash took during the last year and this one. There were many warrants enforced in Rio de Janeiro, São Paulo, and Bahia. But the focus was indeed João Santana and his wife, and also Zviz Konik, who was a well-known consultant here in Rio de Janeiro in the oil and gas industry for dealing with Petrobras.
The name acarajé, and by the way, for those of you who can see the picture, this is a picture of an acarajé. This is a very savory dish from the state of Bahia, where Odebrecht family has their roots. And the state was named acarajé because there were a number of communications among Odebrecht executives saying that, well, we have some acarajés for you. And the federal police believes that whenever they were referring to acarajé, they actually were referring to funds, illegal funds or money or bribes being available to the recipient of the message.
And then about 15 days ago, we had the last phase of Operation Kalash, at least till now, which is called Aleluia, and it's a Greek word for truth and reality. And it's allegedly trying to unveil the relation between a former president, Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva, and construction companies involved in the corruption scheme in Petrobras. And former President Lula himself was detained for questioning, and this that was about 2 weeks ago, and this was a reason for a great turmoil here in Brazil. We have different reactions to this this measure by Judge Moro and the federal, which was requested by the federal police, and many attorneys and judges understand that this his detention was illegal because he had not been he did not refuse to collaborate with the court before, But public opinion in general was favorable to his detention, affirming that he was a regular people, just as anyone else, and he was also subject to law enforcement.
This is an interesting fact that may actually affect the next phases of Operation Car Wash. So historically, someone could not be detained for questioning unless they have been previously summoned to be deposed, and if the person fails to appear once the person is summoned, then detention makes sense and was generally approved. But Judge Morrow had the custom of determining the detentions for questioning of several individuals involved in Operation Car Wash, regardless of a previous invitation or a previous summons for them to be deposed. And this is what happened to former President Lula, and there was general outcry because of that. A number of his opposers were actually happy to see him being taken for questioning, but a general reaction from a number of judges has been that Judge Morrow might have overstepped there, and that he should have invited us or summoned him to be deposed prior to determining his detention. It is possible that Judge Morrow and other judges will be fairly cautious now in determining new detentions to avoid a similar reaction. As a reaction to Alicia, in addition to the general public reaction, President Rousseff also provided her public support to Lula, and she at the time has considered inviting him to become a minister so that he would become entitled to what is known as a privilege of venue, which is being entitled to be prosecuted only by the Supreme Court. At the time that this was offered, it was initially dismissed, and then there was several developments that resulted in today he agreeing to become her chief of staff, and he has accepted the nomination to become a minister, and he's likely going to be appointed tomorrow once the nomination is published at the Official Gazette. Once he becomes a minister, then he can only be prosecuted by the Supreme Court.
Yes, and last Sunday we had demonstrations reacting to this possible, what was then a possible appointment by President Dilma of Lula as a minister. And this was just after the Operation Car Wash and its investigations were demonstrating that former President Lula was any time being involved in the investigations. And the federal Supreme Court had cited before that investigations which were not directly related to the facts being investigated in Curitiba were to be investigated by local prosecutors. And then the São Paulo prosecutor head of the investigation against Lula, which is being currently investigated for indirectly owning two real estate properties donated by a construction company. He requested the state judge to arrest President Lula, and then the judge understood that the investigation was to be returned to Curitiba, and Judge Morrow was to decide on the request for a former President Lula preventive arrest.
So it's interesting that once the Judge Moro determined the detention of President Tallulah, the race to arrest Lula started, and with the state public prosecutors in Sao Paulo and the federal public prosecutors in Brasilia, in Curitiba, trying to see who will be the one to actually detain the arrest of Lula. But now apparently the race is decided. If he is a minister, he can only be arrested by the order of the Supreme Court. So at least for as long as he remains in office, he can only be arrested by the Supreme Court. In the last weekend, a couple of interesting facts also happened in the political sphere that may have some implications on Operation Car Wash. First is the PMDB, which is the party of Vice President Temer. They have prohibited the members, its members, to accept appointments at the federal government. And also they started procedures to leave, to officially leave the support of President Rousseff. This will be decided in 30 days. But a number of state state directories of the parties have decided to leave the government. The first one to do so was the state of Santa Catarina, and there are other states that expect to leave the government and start to oppose the government. As Arturo mentioned, over the weekend there were also massive demonstrations against President Lula and President Rousseff. And demonstrations were in all states of Brazil. And according to the organizers, they had a total of 6.5 million people demonstrating in the streets. According to the police, the numbers were much lower, around 3.5 million people, which is already the largest demonstration in the history of the country.
Selim, before you move on, could I just, we just have gotten a couple of questions in that I thought might be useful to address now, because I think it may be a little bit more topical. First is really, could you explain a little bit more about the legal and practical consequences of former President Lula becoming a minister? And sort of relatedly, is it politically and legally permissible to appoint somebody to a position like that in the face of the various investigations that are targeting him?
Yeah, that's a very good question, and that has been raised by the opposition parties. So the main implication to Operation Car Wash is that all of the proceedings that are deal with President Lula now have to go to the Supreme Court. So Judge Moro has been so far investigating former President Lula and his family, and has been conducting depositions and approving plea bargains himself. All of his actions have so far been approved by the Court of Appeals, the Federal Court of Appeals, and also by the Supreme Court whenever they reached the Supreme Court. So we do not think that there will be too much of a change in terms of how the courts will deal with the facts. But the truth is that Judge Moro is a judge that basically does that. He's basically working on Operation Car Wash. His court is overwhelmed with information on the case. He knows the case by heart, and he has been very fast in his decision. The Supreme Court has a number of other different incumbencies. They have to deal with several different matters, and while they have been very fast in making decisions involving Operation Car Wash, they have been very fast at a Supreme Court pace, which means that things take much longer than usual. It also means that at the Supreme Court, they will be judging a case from its inception, meaning that they will have to deal with discovery, with all of the issues that the Supreme Court and the Court of Appeals generally do not deal with, and the justices, although they are obviously very knowledgeable and very experienced. They are not used, and especially their staff members, they are not used to dealing with this type of procedures. So this means that the process will take much longer. It also means that whenever something implicates former President Lula, the case will have to be sent to the Supreme Court. And whenever an evidence implicates former President Lula, the evidence will need to be sent to the Supreme Court to be approved by the justices of the Supreme Court. This will drag the process down. It will take a little longer for decisions to be made. One thing that President Lula was expecting to deal with his appointment as a minister was that he would be able to remove not only the proceedings against him, but also the proceedings against his family to the Supreme Court. However, just yesterday, the Supreme Court decided that the proceedings against the family of the Speaker of the House, the family of Eduardo Cunha, they should be judged by Judge Morrow and not by the Supreme Court. So it is very likely that the Supreme Court will decide the same with respect to the family of Lula, and even though he will be judged at the Supreme Court, His family can be judged by Judge Morrow. So there is a chance that we will see former President Lula's wife and kids being arrested before the Supreme Court actually makes a decision on President Lula. This is the legal implication to the case. The political implication to the case is that Lula's appointment to be a minister is seen by the opposing parties as an admission of guilt by Lula, and also as an attempt to regain some popularity and to have some grasp of the government, which was basically losing all of its face. In the last couple of weeks. So the general perception is that with Lula and the government, Dilma basically unofficially steps aside. He becomes the actual head of government, although not the head of state. And let's put it like this. Impeachment becomes a little bit less likely. The general view is that it might not be enough to avoid impeachment, but the government has gained a little bit of some extra life expectancy. The challenge to his appointment as a minister, due to the fact that he's facing the prosecution, is a valid challenge. If his appointment to be a minister was only to remove the case from the local courts to the Supreme Court, that could be interpreted as an inappropriate interference with the process and possibly obstruction of justice. The problem is that there are political reasons to appoint Lula. President Rousseff acknowledge his political importance, and it'll be very difficult for, and she has the prerogative of appointing whomever she believes is appropriate to be a minister. So I think that whomever is making this claim that he should not be appointed, and whomever is trying to bar his appointment, will likely not succeed based on the fact that she has a constitutional prerogative to appoint whomever she wants. One thing we have to remember is that President Lula, although facing an investigation, he has not even been indicted. His indictment has been requested, but it has not yet been approved. Even if he had been indicted, he would not have been convicted. So there are a number of different ministers being that have been indicted, and a number of different ministers there are being investigated. There's no reason to treat him differently from the other ministers. So that's where we are in that press of discussions.
So Slim, can I ask another follow-up question, which is really about the Supreme Court now? The first is there confidence in Brazil in the fairness of the Supreme Court, given the fact that Lula and Rousseff have probably appointed many of the justices to that position? And second, from a resources perspective, with so many high political figures in Brazil now being sort of referred to the Supreme Court for trials, does it have the bandwidth, the time and the resources it's going to take to adjudicate these cases in anything like a reasonable amount of time?
Well, let me take the first question first, which is whether what is the general view of the impartiality of the Supreme Court? Well, on that, there has been a fair amount of outcry due to the fact, as you pointed out, that Lula and Rousseff have appointed most of the Supreme Court justices, and some people question the independence and impartiality of the court. However, if we look at the past cases and how the court has been deciding, the court has shown to be quite independent, not always approving what the general public opinion expects, but in all cases they have solid legal grounds to do so.
And it's even valid to recall the Mensalão case, in which the Supreme Court convicted many political figures from the Workers' Party, which were involved.
Yes, that's correct. On your second question, on whether or not they have the bandwidth to deal with all that, I believe that the answer is no. They are not, I mean, they are used to a huge amount of cases. When we think of the U.S. Supreme Court dealing with a small amount of cases per year, the Brazilian Supreme Court has a total different configuration, and they deal with maybe 10 10 times more cases than the U.S. Supreme Court. However, they do not deal with a number of procedures that are generally dealt with by the lower courts, such as disclosure and discovery and entry measures, investigations, all these types of more bureaucratic activities. So it is very likely that cases will take longer. If we compare the Mensalão case with the decisions made by Judge Moro, which is a lower court judge. Judge Moro sentences his defendant in about 6 to 12 months. Whereas if you look at Mensalão, the award was, final award was issued about 5 years after the investigation started. So it is very likely that the case in the Supreme Court will take much longer. But the Supreme Court has been very fast in responding to the demands of Operation Car Wash. So I think that they will make an effort to give some priority to Operation Car Wash. And it will obviously take much longer than what it took with Judge Moro. Just to draw a comparison with Mensalão, the court has been reorganized since Mensalão. During Mensalão, the entire court had to vote on all cases, whereas now they have split the court into panels, one civil panel, and only the criminal panel votes on the day-to-day cases. So it's more likely that cases will be much faster than Mensalão, but yes, it will probably take longer than as if Judge Moro was voting.
And it's also important to highlight that Judge Moro's decision would be subject to the Court of Appeals and the Superior Court of Justice, and the Federal Supreme Court itself. And when you're dealing with a case before the Federal Supreme Court, you have a final award at the end of it.
Yeah, there's no appeal from the highest court in the country.
Yeah. So we're now moving to the current, there, sorry?
I had one last question before you guys wrap up on what's going on in Brazil,
sure.
Which is a great question that's come in from one of the folks who's watching this is, if President Rousseff is impeached and convicted by the Senate, I guess, who becomes the president? Or does that trigger new elections?
Okay, that's actually, there are different outcomes to what's going on. One is that President Rousseff is not impeached and she remains in power. Or now is Lula appointed as her chief of staff, and according to some as a super minister. She remains as an emeritus president, and Lula actually takes the grasp of the government. And the other possibility is that she's impeached. If that happens, then Vice President Temer takes over, and he becomes the president. Vice President Temer is a member of PMDB, which is the party, the largest party in the country. They have been supporting pretty much all governments, and if that happens, he's likely going to side with the parties that are now in the opposition, and he will likely be able to do a transition government with the support of his own party and the opposition parties. Another possibility that could happen, and is that a fair amount of the information that surfaced with Operation Kawash indicated that during the presidential campaign of 2014, some illegal funds were used or were funneled to the campaign of President Rousseff. There's a proceeding going on at the Superior Electoral Court. And that court can issue a decision actually voiding the election of the entire ticket. If that happens, both President Rousseff and Vice President Temer are removed. Vice President Temer has filed a motion asking to be judged separately from President Rousseff. There has never been a case that has been decided in this manner, so we don't know if the courts will decide that way. If that happens, and the entire court and the entire ticket is removed, then the current understanding of the courts is that new elections have to be called. Until recently, the runner-up would be called to take office, but the current understanding is that a new election needs to be called. If this happens this year, then general elections need to be called in the country, and the president has to be appointed by direct vote. If this happens starting next year, since it will be at least 50% of the term will have lapsed, then the election is done by Congress indirectly. The likelihood of this happening, however, is not clear. The court will need to make a decision that could potentially generate much more stability in the country than an impeachment process, for instance. And since the judges are not actually required to issue their votes within a certain period of time, it is possible that a judge will simply take the proceedings home, will take some time to read them, and will not return with a decision for a while to avoid making a decision that could generate so much instability. So it's also a possibility that is being considered, but it may happen or not happen. There's too much political concerns to be considered around that. Going back to what is the current status of Operation Kawash in Brazil? Arthur, do you want to let us know?
There's investigations and criminal proceedings being conducted at the Supreme Federal Supreme Court against sitting members of Congress and ministers of state and also in the federal court in Curitiba. And there have been some convictions, including Marcelo Odebrecht, who was the president of the board of directors of the Odebrecht holding, the Odebrecht group. And there are also some administrative proceedings against companies before the CGU and CADE, which is the Brazilian Antitrust Authority. And there are also some improbity lawsuits against individuals and companies, including Odebrecht, which the Federal Prosecutor's Office filed last week an improbity lawsuit against Odebrecht for approximately 7 billion reais for the damages caused by the corruption scandal, the Odebrecht involvement in the corruption scandal of Operation Car Wash.
And that's interesting because if you may recall, Petrobras believed that they suffered 6.2 billion reais in losses, but the public prosecutors are requesting 7.3 billion in restitution from Odebrecht. The discrepancy between the amounts is that on top of restitution, the public prosecutors are also asking for fines to be imposed on Odebrecht. That's why Odebrecht would end up paying more than Petrobras thinks that they are owed. So what to expect next in Brazil? Well, the investigations are going on, and there is still a fair amount of plea bargains being negotiated. There are rumors that Marcelo Odebrecht himself is negotiating a plea bargain, that the wife of João Santana is negotiating a plea bargain, and so there's a fair amount of information more to surface. The plea bargain of Chancellor Delcídio Amaral has implicated a number of politicians of the government and also of the opposition, such as former runner-up at the presidential campaign, Aécio Neves. As the investigations get very close to the politicians, this creates some political impact. This creates political instability, and also it may affect the impeachment process. What we have seen so far since the middle of 2014 to today is that Congress has basically come to a halt to wait for the investigations. And as the investigations continue, it becomes more difficult for the government to approve the measures that are needed in the economy. In parallel, we see a number of different companies considering a leniency agreement. There was a change in law in the end of last year. Back then, until the change in law, the companies were required to admit guilt and admit the wrongdoings. Now they are not required to do that anymore. And that might ease the process for some companies to apply for a leniency agreement because they are not required to admit guilt. They will pay a fine, they will avoid the penalties, and they'll be able to move on. Apparently, some of the companies that have international exposure, and Odebrecht included, were very concerned with the requirement to admit guilt because that would also trigger proceedings in different jurisdictions. Talking about different jurisdictions, Kelly, what do you think are the implications? I mean, what is the status of these investigations in the U.S., and what do you think that can happen next? Kelly?
Thank you, Slim. I'm sorry about that. There's obviously a number of possibilities about what could happen next in the United States. The Department of Justice and the Securities and Exchange Commission have both publicly announced, I guess Petrobras has actually publicly announced, that they are being investigated by the DOJ and the SEC. And the big question there, of course, is going to be whether or not the DOJ or the SEC will take independent action against Petrobras. Petrobras is traded in the United States, so both entities clearly have jurisdiction. And I think it becomes a discretionary call on the DOJ's part as to whether they want to move forward with a criminal case. That will depend in part on what the results are in the United States and the extent to which Petrobras is keeping the U.S. DOJ sort of engaged as it moves forward in Brazil as well. There's obviously some potential differences in terms of how the Brazilians view Petrobras, which is often as a victim and how prosecutors in the United States would traditionally view a company like this, which would be sort of a fulcrum of a bribe conspiracy. And so there's going to be a variety of sort of law enforcement and I think sort of political, like foreign relations questions that are going to get resolved there. I also think that there could be a big difference between how DOJ and the SEC approach this. The SEC as a market regulator has watched Petrobras's market cap collapse in the United States, of course, and elsewhere. And with an obligation to protect shareholders, it may have to consider bringing an action against Petrobras, even if the DOJ is reluctant to do so, because it really can't tolerate the kind of asset markups and things like that that seem to have occurred at Petrobras from a securities perspective. Aside from the direct actions, you've also got the United States DOJ providing assistance to the Brazilian authorities and to authorities in other countries, frankly. They trace assets. That's one of the things that they do routinely. And so once money leaves the Brazil, for example, it will often pass through a bank in the United States on its way to another place, and you know, whether it's the Caymans or Switzerland or some other place. And the Brazilians have requested, and the U.S. is providing whatever assistance it can provide, as are others, like Switzerland. And so what we now are seeing is an investigation that is not a Brazilian investigation anymore. It's not a U.S. investigation anymore. It's really become a global investigation. According to press reports, there are tens of millions of dollars that have been frozen around the world, accounts that were held by Petrobras executives or by the counterparties. The U.S. and the Swiss have been playing a leading role, but they're not the only ones. And we're now seeing parallel investigations erupting throughout other Latin American countries. Argentina, for one, has been in the news lately for announcing that they were opening an investigation. It's not just Petrobras. Odebrecht is also critically important. It's a significant construction company. It does a lot of public works. And because of that, we're seeing a number of countries either formally opening investigations or at least conducting asset inquiries or audits of the work that they've had done by Odebrecht because they're concerned about it. That's now cropped up in Peru, in Panama, in Ecuador, in Argentina. So what does that tell us? What can we take away from this? There's a bigger picture. The first is that multipolar enforcement is the new reality. The companies that are caught up in Petrobras, they face scrutiny all over the world. So we've already seen SBM Offshore settle in the Netherlands. We've seen companies settle with Brazil. We've seen the Swiss providing information to the Brazilians and potential additional enforcement there. We've got the United States with its open investigations of Petrobras and counterparties. We've got countries like Argentina that are now on board. And what we're seeing is a focus where home jurisdictions, so for example, in the case of SBM, where the Netherlands has taken an active role in trying to enforce conduct to ensure that the companies that are based in the Netherlands, for example, or that have significant connections there, do not engage in conduct overseas that is problematic from the regulator's perspective. Even Brazil has recently gotten into that act, and they've announced that they're going to launch an initiative to monitor Brazilian firms' conduct outside of Brazil. In the UK, for what it's worth, has finally successfully enforced the UK Bribery Act. So we're seeing a maturation, if you will, in the global anti-corruption regimes of multiple countries, where it's not just the United States anymore, and it's not just domestic issues anymore, that international bribery has become a significant enforcement spot for multiple regulators across the globe. And with that, I see we're hitting 201. And we do our best to keep these things to 1 hour exactly. And so we appreciate everyone who's dialed in. If you submitted a question that wasn't answered, we will follow up with you directly. And if you have any additional questions related to today's topic, please email them to Annie Ledger at aledger, that's A-L-E-G-E-R, at mayorbrown.com. And your questions will be promptly forwarded to the speakers. Thank you again for your participation, and have a great day.